was a beautiful morning on the island of Sodor. Thomas the Tank Engine's blue paint sparkled in the sunshine as he puffed happily along his branch line with Annie and Clarabelle. He was feeling very pleased with himself. Hello, Thomas, whistled Percy. You look splendid. Yes, indeed, boasted Thomas. Blue is the only proper color for an engine.
Oh, I don't know. I like my brown paint, said Toby.
I've always been green. I wouldn't want to be any other color either, added Percy.
Well, anyway, huffed Thomas. Blue is the only color for a really useful engine. Everyone knows that.
Percy said no more. He just grinned at Toby. Later, Thomas was resting when Percy arrived. A large hopper was loading his trucks full of coal. Thomas was still being cheeky.
Careful, he warned. Watch out with those silly trucks.
Go on, go on, go on, muttered the truck.
And by the way, went on Thomas, those buffers don't look very safe to me.
The last load poured down.
Help! I'm choking!
Cried Thomas.
Get me out!
Percy was worried, but he couldn't help laughing. Thomas's smart blue paint was covered in coal dust from smoke box to bunker.
Chuckled Percy. You don't look really useful now, Thomas. You look really disgraceful.
I'm not disgraceful, choked Thomas. You did that on purpose. Get me out.
It took so long to clean Thomas that he wasn't in time for his next train. Toby had to take Annie and Clarabelle. Poor Thomas, whispered Annie to Clarabelle. They were most upset. Thomas was grumpy in the shed that night. Toby thought it a great joke. But Percy was cross with Thomas for thinking he had made his paint dirty on purpose. Fancy! A really useful blue engine like Thomas becoming a disgrace to the Fat Controller's Railway. Next day, Thomas was feeling more cheerful as he watched Percy bring his trucks from the junction. The trucks were heavy and Percy was tired. Have a drink, said his driver, then you'll feel better. A water column stood at the end of the siding with the unsafe buffers.
Suddenly, Percy found that he couldn't stop.
The buffers didn't stop him either.
Oh, wailed Percy, help!
The buffers were broken and Percy was wheel deep in coal. It was time for Thomas to leave. He had seen everything. Now Percy has learned his lesson too, he chuckled to himself. That night, the two engines made up their quarrel. I didn't cause your accident on purpose, Thomas, whispered Percy. You do know that, don't you? Of course, replied Thomas, and I'm sorry I was cheeky. Your green paint looks splendid again, too. In future, we'll both be more careful of coal.
Thank you.
Thomas's branch line is important, and so is Edward's. But their track and bridges are not so strong as those on the main line. A fat controller does not allow the heavier mainline engines like Gordon to run on them. But one day, the way Gordon was talking, you would have thought the fat controller had given this order for quite another reason.
It's not fair, grumbled Gordon.
What isn't fair? Asked Edward.
Letting branch line diesels pull main line trains.
Never mind, Gordon. I'm sure Boker will let you pull his truck sometime.
Gordon spluttered. I won't pull Boko's dirty trucks. I won't run on branch lines.
Why not? Would be a nice change.
The fat controller would never approve, huffed Gordon.
Branch lines are vulgar. Gordon puffed away. Edward chuckled and followed him to the station. Every evening, the two engines pull two fast trains from the station. Gordon always leaves first with an express for the main line. Edward follows 5 minutes later with his train for the branch line. Usually, everything runs like clockwork. But tonight, there was trouble. A lady in a green floppy hat was saying goodbye to a friend. It was nearly time for Gordon to start. The fireman looked back towards the guards van and saw something green waving. Right away, mate! He thought the guard had waved his flag. Gordon started, leaving luggage, his passengers and the guard all standing on the platform. Everyone was very surprised and cross. To make matters worse, by the time Gordon had been stopped and brought back, Edward was already late with his train. So now he set off first. But the signalman at the junction wasn't told about the change. By mistake, he sent Edward along the main line. Gordon was sent along the branch and arrived cold and cross on one of the sidings near the harbour. Next morning, Bill and Ben peeped into the yard. There were no trucks for them, but they didn't mind that. Teasing Gordon would be much better fun.
What's that? Asked Bill.
Shh, whispered Ben. It's Gordon.
It looks like Gordon. But it can't be. Gordon never comes on the branch lines. He thinks them vulgar.
Gordon pretended he hadn't heard them.
If it isn't Gordon, said Ben, it's just a pile of old iron, which we'd better take to the scrapyard.
No, Bill, this lot's useless for scrap. We'll take it to the harbour and dump it in the sea.
Gordon was alarmed. I am Gordon. Stop, stop!
When Boko suddenly arrived, Gordon thought him the most beautiful sight he had ever seen.
Boko, my dear engine, save me!
Boko quickly sized up the situation and threatened to take away the trucks he had brought for Bill and Ben. This made the twins behave at once.
Gordon thought he was wonderful. Those little demons, how do you do it?
Oh, well, said Boko, it's just a knack. Gordon still believes that Boko saved his life. But we know the twins were only teasing, don't we? Bertie the bus was giving some visitors a tour of the island of Sodor. It was their last afternoon, and Edward was preparing to take them to meet Bill and Ben. He found it hard to start the heavy train.
Did you see him straining? Asked Henry.
Positively painful, remarked James.
Just pathetic, grunted Gordon.
He should give up and be preserved before it's too late.
Shut up, burst out Duck. You're all jealous. Edward's better than any of you.
You're right, Duck, said Boko. Edward's old, but he'll surprise us all.
I've done it! We're off! I've done it! We're off! Said Edward as he finally puffed out of the station.
Bill and Ben were delighted to see the visitors. They loved being photographed. Later, they took the party to the China Clay Works in a break band special. Everyone had a splendid time, and the visitors were most impressed. Then Edward took the visitors home. On the way, the weather changed. Wind and rain buffeted Edward. His sanding gear failed, and his fireman rode in front, dropping sand on the rails by hand. Suddenly, Edward's wheels slipped fiercely. With a shrieking crack, something broke. The crew inspected the damage. Repairs took some time.
One of your crank pins broke, Edward, said his driver. We've taken your side rods off. Now you're like an old-fashioned engine. Can you get these people home? They must start back tonight.
I'll try, sir, promised Edward. Edward puffed and pulled his hardest, but his wheels kept slipping and he could not start the heavy train. The passengers were anxious. Driver, fireman, and guard went along the train, making adjustments between the coaches.
We've loosened the couplings, Edward. Now you can pick your coaches up one by one, just as you do with trucks.
That will be much easier, said Edward.
Come on,
he puffed, and moved cautiously forward. The first coach moving helped to start the second, and the second helped the third.
I've done it, puffed Edward.
Steady, boy, warned his driver. Well done, boy.
You've got them, you've got them.
And he listened happily to Edward's steady beat as he forged slowly but surely ahead. At last, battered, weary, but unbeaten, Edward steamed in.
Henry was waiting for the visitors with the special train.
Peep, peep!
The fat controller angrily pointed to the clock, but excited passengers cheered and thanked Edward, his driver and fireman. Duck and Boko saw to it that Edward was left in peace. Gordon and James remained respectfully silent.
Percy works in the yard at the big station.
He
loves playing jokes, but they can get him into trouble. One morning, he was very cheeky indeed.
Peep, peep!
Hurry up, Gordon, the train's ready. Gordon thought he was late. Ha, 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 laughed Percy and showed him a train of dirty coal trucks. Gordon thought how to pay Percy out. Next, it was James's turn. Stay in the shed today, James. The Fat Controller will come and see you. Ah, thought James. The Fat Controller knows I'm a fine engine. He wants me to pull a special train. James's driver and fireman could not make him move. The other engines grumbled dreadfully. They had to do James's work as well as their own. At last, the inspector arrived. Show a wheel, James. You can't stay here all day. The Fat Controller told me to stay here. He sent a message this morning. He did not. How could he? He's away for a week. Oh, said James. Oh, where's Percy? Percy had wisely disappeared. When the Fat Controller came back, he did see James and Percy too. Both engines wished he hadn't. One morning, Percy was careless. I say, you engines, I'm to take some trucks to Thomas's Junction. The Fat Controller chose me especially. He must know I'm a really useful engine. More likely he wants you out the way, grunted James. Gordon looked across to James. They were making a plan. James and I were just speaking about signals at the junction. We can't be too careful about signals. But then I needn't say that to a really useful engine like you, Percy. Percy felt flattered. We had spoken of backing signals, put in James. They need extra special care, you know. Would you like me to explain? No, thank you, James, said Percy. I know all about signals. Percy was a little worried. I wonder what backing signals are, he thought. Never mind, I'll manage. He puffed crossly to his trucks and felt better. He came to a signal. Bother, it's at danger. The signal moved to show line clear. Its arm moved up instead of down. Percy had never seen that sort of signal before. Down means go and up means stop. So upper still must mean go back. I know, it's one of those backing signals. Come on, Percy, said his driver. Off we go. Stop! You're going the wrong way. But it's a backing signal, Percy protested and told him about Gordon and James. The driver laughed and explained. Oh, dear, said Percy. Let's start quickly before they see us. He was too late. Gordon saw everything. That night, the big engines talked about signals. They thought the subject was funny. Percy thought they were being very silly. What? Asked Percy.
What?
Grunted Gordon. Do you know what?
Silly,
said Gordon. Of course I don't know what. If you don't tell me what is. The Fat Controller says that the work in the yard is too heavy for me. He's getting a bigger engine to help me. Rubbish, said James. Any engine could do it. If you worked more and chatted less, this yard would be a sweeter, a better, and a happier place. Percy went off to fetch some coaches. That stupid old signal, he thought. He was remembering the time he'd misunderstood a signal and gone backwards instead of forwards. No one listens to me now. They think I'm a silly little engine and order me about. I'll show them. I'll show them, but he didn't know how. By the end of the afternoon, he felt tired and unhappy. He brought some coaches to the station. Hello, Percy, said the Fat Controller. You look tired. Yes, sir, I am, sir. I don't know if I'm standing on my dome or my wheels. You look the right way up to me, laughed the Fat Controller. Cheer up. The new engine is bigger than you and can probably do the work alone. Would you like to help build my new harbour? Thomas and Toby will help. Oh, yes, sir. Thank you, sir. The new engine arrived. What's your name? Asked the Fat Controller. Montague, sir, but I'm usually called Duck. They say I waddle. I don't really, sir, but I like Duck better than Montague. Good. Duck it shall be. Here, Percy, show Duck round. The two engines went off together. Soon they were very busy. James, Gordon, and Henry watched Duck quietly doing his work. He seems a simple sort of engine. We'll have some fun and order him about. Smoke billowed everywhere. Percy was cross. Duck took no notice. They'll get tired of it soon. Do they tell you to do things, Percy? Yes, they do, answered Percy. Right, said Duck. We'll soon stop that nonsense. He whispered something. We'll do it later. The Fat Controller was looking forward to hot buttered toast for tea at home. Suddenly, he heard an extraordinary noise. Whee! Bother, he said, and hurried to the yard. Duck and Percy calmly sat on the points outside the shed, refusing to let the engines in. Gordon, James, and Henry were furious. Stop that noise, bellowed the Fat Controller.
They won't let us in, hissed Gordon.
Duck, explain this behavior. Beg pardon, sir, but I'm a Great Western engine. We do our work without fuss. But begging your pardon, sir, Percy and I would be glad if you would inform these engines that we only take orders from you.
Silence!
Snapped the Fat Controller. Percy and Duck, I am pleased with your work today, but not with your behavior tonight. You have caused a disturbance. Gordon, Henry, and James sniggered. As for you, thundered the Fat Controller, you've been worse. You made the disturbance. Duck is quite right. This is my railway, and I give the orders. After Percy went away, Duck was left to manage alone. He did so, easily. One day, Thomas was at the junction when Gordon shuffled in with some trucks.
Phew!
remarked Thomas. What a funny smell. Can you smell a smell? I can't smell a smell, said Annie. A funny, musty sort of smell, said Thomas. No one noticed it till you did, grunted Gordon. It must be yours. Not long ago, he had fallen into a dirty ditch. Thomas enjoyed teasing him about it. Annie, Clarabelle, do you know what I think it is? It's ditch water. Before Gordon could answer, Thomas puffed away. Annie and Clarabelle could hardly believe their ears. He's dreadfully rude. I feel quite ashamed. I feel quite ashamed. He's dreadfully rude. And to Thomas, they said, you mustn't be rude. You make us ashamed. But Thomas didn't care a bit. That was funny. That was funny, he chuckled. He felt very pleased with himself. Annie and Clarabelle were deeply shocked. They had great respect for Gordon, the big engine. Thomas left the coaches at the station and went off to a mine for some trucks. Long ago, miners digging for lead had made tunnels under the ground. Their roofs are strong enough to hold up trucks, but not the weight of engines. A large notice warns them not to enter the area. Danger! Engines must not pass this board. Silly old board, thought Thomas. He had often tried to pass it, but had never succeeded. But this morning he had made a plan. The fireman went to turn the points. Now for my plan, thought Thomas. Pumping the trucks fiercely, he jerked his driver off the footplate and followed them into the siding. Come back, yelled his driver. Fire and smoke, said Thomas. I am sunk. And he was. Oh dear, he said, I am a silly engine. And a very naughty one, too. I saw you, said the fat controller. Please get me out. I won't be naughty again. I'm not sure. We can't lift you out with a crane. The ground's not firm enough. Let me see. I wonder if Gordon could pull you out. Yes, sir, said Thomas. But he didn't want to meet Gordon just yet. Down a mine, is he? Ha, 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 laughed Gordon. What a joke! Poop, poop, little Thomas. We'll have you out in a couple of puffs. Strong cables were fastened between the two engines. Are you ready? Heave! It was a lot harder than they all thought, but at last Thomas was free. I'm sorry I was cheeky, said Thomas. That's all right, Thomas, you made me laugh, replied Gordon. I'm in disgrace. So am I, said Thomas. Why, so you are, Thomas. Shall we form an alliance? You help me and I'll help you. Right you are, agreed Thomas. Good, that's settled, rumbled Gordon. And buffer to buffer, the allies puffed home. Trevor, the traction engine, enjoyed living in the vicarage orchard. Edward came to see him every day, but sometimes Trevor didn't have enough work to do. I do like to keep busy all the time,
he sighed one day. And I do like company, especially children's company. Cheer up, smiled Edward. The Fat Controller has work for you at his new harbour. I'm to take you to meet Thomas today.
Ah, exclaimed Trevor happily. A harbour, the seaside, children, that will be lovely.
Thomas was on his way to the harbour with a trainload of metal pilings. They were needed to make the harbour wall firm and safe.
Hello, Thomas, said Edward. This is Trevor, a friend of mine. He's a traction engine.
Thomas eyed the newcomer doubtfully.
A what engine? He asked.
A traction engine, explained Trevor. I run on roads instead of rails.
Can you take me to the harbour, please? The Fat Controller has a job for me.
Yes, of course, replied Thomas, but he was still puzzled.
Workmen coupled Trevor's truck to Thomas's train, and soon they were ready to start their journey.
I'm glad the Fat Controller needs me, called Trevor. I don't have enough to do sometimes, you know. Although I can work anywhere. In orchards, on farms, in scrapyards, even at harbours.
But you don't run on rails, puffed Thomas.
I'm a traction engine. I don't need rails to be useful, replied Trevor. You wait and see.
When they reached the harbour, they found everything in confusion. Trucks had been derailed, blocking the line, and stone slabs lay everywhere.
We must get these pilings passed, said Thomas's driver. They are essential. Trevor, we need you to drag them round this mess.
Just the sort of job I like, replied Trevor.
Now you'll see, Thomas. I'll soon show you what traction engines can do. Trevor was as good as his word.
He dragged the pilings clear with chains and towed them into position.
Who needs rails? He muttered cheerfully to himself.
Later, Thomas brought Annie and Clarabel to visit him. Thomas was most impressed.
Now I understand how useful a traction engine can be.
The coaches were full of children. Trevor gave them rides along the harbour. He liked this best of all.
He's very kind, said Annie.
He reminds me of Thomas, added Clarabel.
Everyone was sorry when it was time for Trevor to go. Thomas pulled him to the junction.
A small tear came into Trevor's eye. Thomas pretended not to see. He whistled gaily to make Trevor happy.
I'll come and see you if I can, he promised. The vicar will look after you, and there's plenty of work for you now at the orchard. But we may need you again at the harbour someday.
That would be wonderful, said Trevor.
That evening, Trevor stood remembering his new friend Thomas, the harbour, and most of all, the children. Then he went happily to sleep in the shed at the bottom of the orchard.